I think that we don't share, as a culture, we don't share grief very well.
Mm-hmm.
I think that, I mean, partly it's the culture, but it's partly capitalism that we don't have give ourselves time or even space mm-hmm. to grieve, at least, you know, to step into the grief without feeling embarrassment or like, you know, that we should have moved on by now. Or so, yeah, so I mean, that was the side of the fish I landed on, was that actually there's shame, the shame of disclosure, but there's also the shame of enclosure, of keeping things too kind of fenced in.
The library was my space, and there was just so much.
To the Harbor Grace excursion with the boys to have a time.
I can't tell you how much I enjoyed reading this book. It is so rare to encounter a book of profound literary beauty that is also a riveting page-turner. There's a plot in this. It's a nonfiction book, but it reads sometimes like gripping fiction and also sometimes like magnificent poetry. So I really, really encourage you to read it. For the purposes of this discussion, there are some elements that are spoilers that I'm not going to get into. So we're going to tap dance a bit around it, but I still hope to provide you with a fascinating discussion and some questions that I hope will bring the great richness of this book to light. So at the center of this book are your parents. Why don't you tell this audience a little bit about them so we can start unpacking the themes that you get into.
So my father was a foreign correspondent and war reporter, and he worked for many years for the CBC, and he was stationed in Tokyo for a long time as a Far East correspondent, and met my mother in 1963. And she was a Japanese artist who was kind of hanging around the embassy and was very much an iconoclast. Like, she really didn't fit in to the kind of culture in Tokyo at the time and the expectations of women. At one point, I kind of described the way she kind of stands with her shoes, or the way she places her shoes, and they're never together, and her sisters would always scold her, and she just wasn't proper in that way. There was a word in Japanese called dadashinai, which means kind of unkempt, and that was the way she was always described. But she was very much an artist, and they met through common friends in Tokyo.
At one point in the book, sort of towards the end, you describe some childhood friends who were very welcoming, and you felt a little guilty because you said you sort of wanted to join their family and slip into their universe. Why did you feel that way? Did you feel slightly not at home in your own family?
Yeah, I mean, my parents were very dissimilar and had a very fractious marriage, and you know, when you're a child, that's your kind of universe, and you don't know that there's another way of being in family. But I knew that it was very, you know, the mood and temperature of the house could change dramatically in a second. And I would spend time in friends' houses, and it wasn't that way. And so I kind of started to see that there was a family structure that could be a bit more stable and kind of consistent. And actually, one of my childhood friends is here in the room today, and her family was very welcoming as well. And although sometimes I'd stand on their porch and wonder, because they would yell at each other as well. But it was always in a kind of like jovial, debating kind of way, as opposed to an angry yelling kind of way. And so I think there was this feeling that I wanted to slip into something a little bit more harmonious.
You describe yourself as always reading as a kid. Were you already writing the story of your parents' life? Were you observing from a kind of critical distance?
That's a very good question. I mean, one of the reasons I read so much as a child was that I was an only child, and we traveled quite a bit, and, you know, books were kind of my siblings. And I think the other thing was that my parents, for all their kind of the tension within their marriage, were very possessive of me. And we, you know, I grew up in a very tight family where it was always like, how loyal can we be? How protected? And there was something a bit suffocating about that, and books kind of opened up this world beyond that kind of sense of enclosure. And so, you know, if my parents were telling me that family should be tight and enclosed, books were saying, like, you can be loose, and you can, like, intermingle, and you can, you know, and when you're a child, like, your sense of identity is so elastic. Like, you think, you know, you can be related to anyone, and you can be kin with, you know, plants and animals. And so I liked reading because I think it opened up a sense of space for me in a kind of world and upbringing that was very, very possessive.
Did you think your parents marriage was as troubled as you later learned it was?
I saw the fight, so I knew that it was a very volatile marriage, but you know, as much as I say that, there was a real thread of tenderness, and I try to examine that in the book a little bit, because I think that they were in some ways very similar, despite this kind of surface dissimilarities. Like, they both came from very kind of lonely childhoods, and I think had a very, kind of just very fragile sense of, you know, of love, and like the idea, I think they really came at love as from an idea of scarcity, that it would always be something scarce. And I think that in some ways they saw that loneliness in each other. And so they kind of tended to it in really kind of unexpected ways. Like they would, I would have thought they would have kind of broken off ties at a certain point, but they always kind of gravitated back together in some ways as friends.
You mentioned that as a child, identity was volatile and transforming as you read different characters in books. In your amazing memoir, you say that you saw Japanese people didn't see you as legitimately Japanese, and white people saw you as very Asian. How did you see yourself?
That's a good question. I think I always saw myself as somebody who was on the outside looking in. And so going back to your other question, I think that's what made me an observer, and that's what kind of put me into the narrative mindset, was that, you know, when I was in Japan, I always felt like a foreigner. You know, growing up in Toronto, I lived in a very white neighborhood, and, you know, the school I attended, I was the only non-white child. And so there was always this sense that I was kind of an ethnographer observing kind of strange customs, and I think that kind of slippy kind of, you know, not sure-footed place was actually a really useful place. Like, it made me kind of more perceptive. Like, I think that when you're in that space, it's like the space of a traveler, you notice things much more acutely. And so, you know, I feel like I became a noticer at a very young age.
Well, I'm very glad you did. In the spring of 2019, you decide to take a DNA test. Why did you decide to do that?
So it was actually like the furthest thing from my mind, but I was just speaking to Sergio, who introduced us, and he said that he recently did a DNA test as well, and he did it in the wake of his father's death as well. And I think there was something about my father dying, and then my father had been so private, like especially about his own kind of like origin family. Like, I knew so little about his upbringing. So little in particular about his mother, and I really wanted to connect with someone on that side of his family, because my uncle had passed through Toronto for the memorial, and he had said a few things about my grandmother that had caused me to kind of wonder a little bit about who she was and the circumstances of her life. And so, you know, I kind of just really wanted to connect with that side of his family. It's like the Gallagher Irish side. And so I did this test thinking that maybe I could find one relative who could answer a few questions.
Then you had you discovered a whole world calls an NPE, a non-paternity event. Is this a, why don't you describe what that felt like on your end?
So, I mean, I think that in some ways my story is kind of uncommon, but in some ways it's very common. I was just doing some reading on this. Like, 10 years ago, 1 million people had done a DNA test. And it was mostly people who were really seeking information. Like, they were adoptees or they were donor conceived, and they really wanted to get to the bottom of a secret. Increasingly, like in the past like 10 years, it's been people who've been doing it for recreational purposes, or kind of like they're maybe interested in their ancestry. They might want to kind of have a sense of family expansion or like connect with DNA relatives. But it's kind of like more of a remove. Like, there's like an emotional, psychological remove. And, you know, it's called recreational ancestry or genealogy for a reason. And so I kind of went in with that kind of mindset. But what I didn't realize was that actually these DNA surprises are very common. Like, it's something like in the range of 2-10% of people who discover their NPE. Right. And so that's misattributed paternity. So people in this room maybe have discovered this, but you discover that your father isn't your father or your biological father. But I didn't know that. So my first reaction was, like, this is clearly wrong. And in fact, I was away, and I texted my husband, who was like, you know, a mistake. And then I said, you know, there was a pause, and he wrote back, you know, you don't even like herring. And then he texted back. He's like, muzzle tub, now you know what that means.
And that's because the DNA indicated that you had Ashkenazi Jewish paternity.
So, but I was, you know, I was so surprised, actually, that I did a second test, because I didn't believe the first test. And in fact, I'm sure there's like customer representatives at Ancestry answering calls around the clock from people who think there's been a misunderstanding or mistake.
So this is where the plot of the book gets very dramatic, and the plot of your life. I experienced it as a reader, and you discover this vast world online of Facebook groups of, you know, midwives to people's DNA journeys. What did you find when you started looking into it?
Well, I have to say, first of all, that I'm as a mixed race person, as someone who's done scholarship around kinship, like I don't really love the idea of the genealogical imagination, the way it's kind of reproduced through ancestry DNA kind of advertisements and kind of the whole discourse around like ancestry, because I feel like it really tends to be quite narrow and biological. And so what I found, first of all, was that a lot of people felt really at sea. Like they felt like they'd got this test result and they were in the throes of an identity crisis. And, you know, I think looking back, I didn't feel like I was having an identity crisis. I think what I was having was a crisis of truth and a crisis of trust, because I realized that I'd been so close to my father, like really, like we had confided in each other so much. And I thought, you know, how could he not have shared this information with me? Like, how could he have underestimated me so much, first of all? And how could he have underestimated himself? And also the idea of family, that we couldn't have been kind of run with this and been like, you know, had it all on the table, right? And so I went on these sites, and a lot of the ideas that were kind of repeated were, you know, I've never felt like I belonged. I'm looking for my true family. Mm-hmm. There would be a lot of reunion photographs where people would be like in matching t-shirts, you know, to kind of reaffirm the idea that biology was like all determining. And so I was really feeling a little bit like I was really invested in the people who felt like they were in the throes of a mystery, because it is like an existential whodunit, you know, like you feel like, what is the, like, I need to crack this story. I need to figure out what really happened. And I identified with that search aspect, but I didn't really identify with all the kind of biology stuff. But I did, through these sites, discover that there's something very helpful, which is called a search angel. So if you find out that you're not biologically related to your parents, you know, you can try to investigate on your own. And maybe if you have that kind of sleuth work mentality, you can get pretty far through, you know, genealogical records. But I couldn't get anywhere. And so I posted something on one of the sites saying I was looking for help, and a search angel, that's what they're called, immediately volunteered within an hour to help me. And it was somebody who lived in San Francisco, and it was entirely volunteer. And I think after we spent like many weeks and into months together, you know, corresponding, and she must have spent, you know, hundreds of hours working on this.
And what is a DNA painter?
So a DNA painter is kind of an app. And what it is she reached a point where she was working through the records. And the thing about Jewish DNA and ancestry is that you'll discover that you have lots of cousins. Like I have tens of, you know, thousands of cousins, and they're second or third cousins. And it's very confusing because of Jewish endogamy that they might not be related to you just in one way. It might be through two lines. Anyway, it's very confusing and difficult to kind of
small untangle. Community and
yeah, I mean, we're probably
rural Poland,
we're probably cousins.
Not much to do.
So she kind of tried to sort through all that, and then she had quite a bit of information, so she loaded it up to this chromosome mapping tool called DNA Painter. And I remember where I was in transit, I was on a train from Toronto to Ottawa, and I get a text from her saying that she's narrowing in, and that she's kind of basically winnowed it down to three possibilities, three possible fathers. And I remember this feeling like, you know, you're kind of like in this mode of digging and searching, and I think partly it was just this I felt so unsettled, you know, and I was just kind of digging almost as a compulsion or kind of out of like as a reflex, and not thinking about what I would find, you know, like, and at that moment it kind of hit home that actually there was going to be an answer. And I realized that I wasn't sure that was what the search was all about, and that maybe I was still in transit in some way, and that maybe the culture's kind of compulsive fixation on this idea of closure was kind of maybe not my compulsion, but it felt like it was had motivated me, that I needed closure. And there was, I think maybe it was because I was on a train, but this feeling that I wasn't actually on my way anywhere, but I was about to be on my way somewhere. I was about to go from family A to family B. Mm-hmm. And I remember feeling kind of unsure about the whole thing.
So at this point, your father has died. Your mother is alive and around to ask questions. And a big part of this amazing book is your interrogation and interaction with her. You actually, it's funny to talk about interviewing while interviewing you, but you, as a teacher of writing, you have discussed the ethics of interviewing. And you teach that you don't want to be an interrogative bully. It's better to use a term I love, speaking nearby. But that you found yourself with loads of questions for your mother. And how did that process go of extracting information from her? Like, what techniques worked? What environments worked? How did you confront her with your learning?
Yeah, it was an interrogative bully. I really was. I mean, I was thinking about it. I think in some ways, like, I am my dad's daughter in the sense that I went in with this kind of reportorial mm-hmm. drive. And I felt, you know, I think it was kind of maybe to be expected because I felt like I really wanted to touch the ground. And I felt like everything was kind of floating in the air. And I felt that if I asked enough questions and I went in with it, you know, looked at it from enough angles, that everything would be sorted out and I would kind of feel settled again. And so, you know, I really interrogated my mother, and she was not, the thing about my mother is that she's never been a kind of reliable narrator, and she's never been a dutiful subject. And so she was like, I think about this kind of like, she was like Houdini, kind of like, anytime I try to box her in and get a version of the story, she kind of like burst out of the box and then like kind of escape. And that happened again and again and again. And so I realized that, you know, even like my fervor, like, and my questioning wasn't actually helping in any way. It was just getting her back up against the wall, mm-hmm. And that I wasn't going to get answers that way.
We're not going to get into every detail of what you discovered, because I do really think you want to buy the book, maybe one for someone you love as well. But there is this remarkable page that just stopped me in my tracks about privacy. You do eventually encounter some relatives, and you learn about lives of all these people who have never asked to be part of a book, didn't set out to be part of a book, and that have become part of your story. And I'm going to actually read this amazing passage about privacy. I'm, of course, a journalist, so this really, I think about this all the time. Like, when is somebody else's story yours to use in a narrative? And you write, he asked you, this relative you discover, are you going to write about this? Are you going to write about this information you've discovered and this person you've discovered? And he says, you write, his question took me by surprise and left a prickle of shame. Did he see me as the kind of sneaky person who was always writing things down, who saw life as cheap material, was writing gauche and unnecessary? Of course not, I replied. Of course, you say, I'm not going to write about this. So this is really complicated. Like, there are these people out in the world who are now part of your narrative, and there's all manner of private details of other people told, in my opinion, lovingly and tenderly and carefully. How did you think about making those decisions?
Yeah, I still am going through this in my mind all the time. I have some students in the room, and this is a very active conversation that we've had in our class, you know, about what the kind of ethics of storytelling are, and you know, it's still an ongoing question for me, but I can tell you this, which is that at a certain point when I was writing, I felt like I tamped down a lot of my doubts and kind of questions, and I felt like, you know, what I was really doing was I knew that I wasn't writing out of malice, I wasn't writing to settle scores, mm-hmm. And that I really felt that at a certain point I had the right to kind of pull together the threads and pieces that I was kind of unearthing to kind of self-create, to kind of create my own story. That's the theory, you know, and at the same time, it's almost like I sent the book off, and my editor's here too, somewhere, but anyway, Martha kind of knows about all the things that go on in my brain, but one thing that happened was that it was like all the shrieking demons and doubts came like out onto the stage of my brain, and actually other people in my family know about this too. Sorry, everyone. But anyway, they started doing this dance in my brain about like how, you know, basically what you've done is terribly wrong and how could you do this to people you love, you know, and that there was just something, and you and I were talking about how there's something murdery about, we were using Janet Malcolm to talk about like how there's something a bit cold-blooded about writing about people you love. And so I really had to discern what was my story to tell and what wasn't mine to tell, and I really actually kept a lot out of this book. And that might surprise people who think that I've actually said a lot, but I actually kept a lot out. At the same time, I did push back when I felt that people were trying to guard things for no good reason. And people on several occasions said to me, "You're not gonna write about this, are you?" Or, you know, "Your father was a very private man." And I really felt that there was some kind of like old residue that we were dealing with. It's like this old shroud of shame and secrecy that I feel like is generational, and that maybe we didn't need to live with those kind of rules anymore. I certainly felt like it didn't serve our family very well. And at the same time, like, and this is like the fish that was kind of flopping back and forth. So I'd be like, okay, I'm fine with this, and no, I'm not okay with it. And it went back and forth and back and forth, and I drove myself crazy, really, about it. The one thing I really know is that I did share facts, a set of facts in this book, that my father, at least, for a very long time, wanted to keep hidden. And that has given me a little anguish, a little bit of sadness, because I feel like, you know, he had certain ideas around disclosure. He was a very private man, you know. And so I feel like I've broken something there. Because when you share your story, you're sharing other people's story as well. And so I just had to be clear about in myself, knowing that I'd done that, and that. But at the same time, the other side, the disclosure thing has really done a number on me, I realized. And that one of the things I think about in terms of inheritance is not just what we inherit, but what we reproduce. And so I inherited a lot of great things from my parents, like the books and the art and all that stuff. But I also inherited a lot of kind of weird ideas about not sharing things, right? Like, so for example, there are people in this room that I love and know very well who don't even know this story because I'm not a good sharer. I need to share better is basically the lesson. I don't need to write a book every time I need to say something. But I'm not a good sharer. And I realized that because, you know, the book starts in a greenhouse, for example, and I'm in a greenhouse. You might think because I love nature and because I love plants, and that's partly it. I really needed to be somewhere where there were living things. And I don't have a church, and I don't have a temple, and I don't go to shul. And so I wanted a ritual, a place. And so I went to the greenhouse every Monday for many weeks. But part of it was that I was hiding. And the mentality there, and when I really thought about it, was that I thought, you know, I will suffer my loss alone, and I will go and hide. And no one will see me, and I will see no one until the worst.
This is after your father died.
Worst of the pain is over. And when I think about it, it's so absurd because I was in a glass house. Like, how do you hide in a glass house? But that was the thinking. That's the way I grew up, was that you kind of weather it alone and then, you know, and you kind of suck it up and whatever. And I actually think this is a shared taboo, though. Like, I think that we don't share, as a culture, we don't share grief very well. Mm-hmm. I think that, partly it's the culture, but it's partly capitalism, that we don't have give ourselves time or even space mm-hmm. to grieve. At least, you know, to step into the grief without feeling embarrassment or like, you know, that we should have moved on by now. Or so, yeah, so I mean, that was the side of the fish I landed on, was that actually there's shame, the shame of disclosure, but there's also the shame of enclosure, of keeping things to kind of fenced in.
You mentioned that there are some things that you left on the cutting room floor that you didn't include, and I am surprised to hear it because it feels so intimate and giving. How did you draw that line?
Well, there are certain people that are still alive, and I didn't, you know, I really wanted to keep people anonymous, you know, protect people that were kind of part of the story and kind of intrinsic to the story, but I really didn't feel like I could share very much about their lives or really, you know, what had happened. And mm-hmm. I certainly didn't share a lot about my siblings that I discovered. Mm-hmm. I don't share very much about them. So I think those were mainly the things.
In journalism and nonfiction reporting, I sort of go by the no surprises rule. Like if you're going to publish something about someone, in addition to being as accurate as you can be and as fair and giving that person opportunity for comment, you also don't want them to like click on their computer and read something and be completely not prepared that it's happening. Did you go to anyone in the book and say, I'm telling this story and you should know what's going to be in it? Or did you go to the greenhouse and hide out? Hope for the best.
I gave everyone the heads up.
Right.
And actually everyone was really okay, pretty okay with it. I don't know. I think that you can invent scenarios in your head, and I think I've really felt the hardest thing for me was around my dad, actually, because of his privacy, but, you know, he's gone. Anyway.
So you mentioned gardening, and that is a big theme in the book, and it's a metaphor, and it's a way that you connect with your mother. Tell this audience a little bit about why gardening matters to you and how the role it occupies in the book.
So, my mother was an avid gardener. So at a certain point, I really wanted to kind of understand, unlock the mystery, I guess. And I needed to get closer to my mother. And I kind of wanted to understand how the secret had shaped her character, but also our relationship. And one of the things in my relationship with my mother that kind of gives me a sense of sorrow, really, is that there's kind of broken cultural transmission, like because I lost my mother tongue, which was Japanese, and that was partly because I lived in a biracial home and my dad didn't speak any Japanese, so the default language was English, and so I really felt like I wanted to speak my mother's language, and I didn't think I could do a crash course in Japanese and learn that fluently. And so I chose her second language, which I thought was like her kind of the wild and green language that she spoke. And so, you know, I'm not a great gardener. My best friend has a series of photographs called Sad Plants, which is kind of like, that's kind of like me, Sad Plants. And I'm not, you know, I didn't become a fancy gardener. Like I have a friend, Stephen Andrews, I don't know if he's in the room, who I consider a fancy gardener. But I certainly didn't become a fancy gardener, but I did learn things in the garden. First of all, I started to remember like really beautiful memories of my mother's garden. And so there was a kind of softness in remembering that because my mother and I had a really difficult relationship. It's changed a little bit, just remembering her tenderness around the garden and that kind of tending and love that she gave to the garden. It was almost like it was triangulated, like she couldn't give it to me directly, but it was through the garden. And so I felt like I was learning things in the garden, also about patience. You know, like I'd call it the opposite of a storyteller's mindset, because with a storyteller mindset, you kind of go in with a sense of control and that you can shape things. Whereas in the garden, at least for me, like I was really not in my element. And so patience, also learning that you can't control things. There'll be moments of drought or like things will take over, or, you know, things like that. But the other aspect is that I'm really interested in what we think of as kind of the ambient world, like, you know, plants and what we call setting or nature. I really want to think about how that kind of vast, hidden, teeming world of plant life that we don't really think of as kind of frontal and like protagonists in our life, how I could bring that to the fore. Because I started to think a lot about how, you know, we see only kind of a fraction of what's going on around us. And actually my bird guide, who I was the star of my book, Birds Art Life, is in the room, Jack Breakfast, or David Bell. And he really showed me that actually, you know, we really don't notice what's going on around us. And so when I started to see plants around me, it really kind of changed the radio dial and frequency. And I realized that in some ways, the way I'd been thinking about my mother was also in an ambient way. Like, she'd been the backdrop to my life. And there was a sense of there-ness, like she was always there, you know, and I could kind of count on her being there. And I didn't really see, I kind of underestimated what a protagonist she was, you know, and that was kind of a really sobering thought.
The book itself is structured in such an imaginative and creative way. There aren't chapters. There are little seasons. How did you come to that architecture?
So it kind of goes back to this idea of the backdrop, because I was thinking about how we think in the West, like in terms of the calendar and seasons, in like four units. Whereas in Japan, there's what's called small seasons, and there's 24 of them. And then within those small seasons, there's micro seasons, and there's 72 of those. And they're really, it's like this really precise poetic phenology where it's like insects awaken, bamboo shoots sprout, you know, thunder rumbles, and those are the seasons, right? And that you start to calibrate your attention differently, and you see that the world is changing all the time. And I really wanted this story to kind of capture the sense that the kind of ground of our stories is ever evolving, and that it's the temperature and color is always changing, and that there's no sense of kind of stable ground. So that was part of it.
There's also a section at the end with a list of things you remember. How did you come to create a section like that?
So that's like kind of my homage to Joe Brainard and Mary Ruffel and Georges Perec, who all did these kind of I remember long poems. And I mean, one thing that I talk about in the book is that both my parents had dementia. And so I really feel at times like I'm the custodian of my family story, and that I'm the rememberer. And I, you know, it's not clear to me that my parents would want me to remember everything, but I felt like a desire to remember on their behalf and to kind of notate what I remembered.
Towards the end of the book, you describe your mother losing her memory and suffering from dementia. And then did you feel there was a race to extract as much information out of her? How did that go?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, you know, there's a moment where I'm questioning her, where I'm wondering, like, is she just a really cagey subject? You know, like, what's going on here? And then, and she would share a story, and then she'd immediately redact it or kind of deny it or rebury it. And I mean, I know that memory is not something that kind of like rises out of the soil, you know, intact, and that it's like you brush it off like an archaeologist. Like, I know that's not the way memory works. Like, we're constantly rewriting memories, but this was beyond that. And then I, you know, around that time, I'd been caring for her through a cancer diagnosis. And she was, like, shortly after she was diagnosed with dementia. And it became clear to me that the memories were actually kind of disappearing to this, like, Bermuda Triangle, and that it wasn't that she was being cagey, that memories were just kind of going. And it was just a really weird time because I was, you know, the story had just kind of been uncovered, and I'd been asking her all these questions. And so for a while, I actually had this strange and maybe unreasonable thought that I'd caused her to unspool, that I was responsible for her undoing in some way. And you mean, like, obviously, if you look in like WebMD under like causes of dementia, this isn't one of them. So, and you know, when I look back, I can see that she had signs of it before, like the pre-diagnosis. But I felt like, you know, once she was, you know, I've already lost the thread of the question, but have I answered
it? Answered it and more.
Okay.
When you completed your book, did you feel like, oh, I've done it. I've wrapped up. I've got my family history. I've uncovered some secrets. I've thought about what it meant to carry all these secrets. And now I'm done with my family's past.
Yeah. No. Well, I mean, one thing about this is that, you know, you realize, and we talked about this, I think, in the class a little bit, this idea that you can't kind of nail anything down in a permanent way, you know, that people are always changing and evolving, and, you know, we can maybe speak to our experience, but our experience of the world is constantly changing, and we're evolving. If we're lucky, we're evolving, you know, and so the idea that you could put people into a tidy narrative box of like, this is who I am, this is who my mother is, this is our story, and this is how we move through the world. Like, I knew that wasn't any of that was garbage. Like, that wasn't truthful, and that wasn't really the reality, and that all I could do was kind of try to capture the wild impossibility of kind of getting this story down, and realize that it was going to keep changing. And so when I get to the end, actually, there's a real moment in the book where I go from being the reporter's daughter, where I think I can sum everything up, to being a daughter who realizes that there's going to be areas that have to stay unknown. And the narration kind of changes at that point a little bit. I think it becomes a little looser as my mother's kind of loosening, and my kind of tight hold on the need for story kind of loosens as well. And, you know, when I got to the end of it, I really had this kind of sense like, okay, I'm okay with the fact that things are going to stay a little bit unresolved. And narrative, you know, I love, you know, certain books that have a sense of narrative irresolution. I'm okay with ambiguity. I love it artistically, aesthetically. But then I was kind of walking around still with this feeling that I wasn't emotionally resolved, and that this experience of being kind of psychically unresolved was also doing a number on me. And that even though I thought I was okay, I was still sitting beside my mother, kind of like waiting for her to share stuff, you know? And I was moving between like the state of anticipation and a state of like self-protective guardedness, because I was worried, you know, that I would never know, and I was just kind of impatient. And I realized that my mother was starting to change. Like, one of the things with dementia was that she was really loosening, and suddenly unfamiliar things were happening. Like, she would smile at me in this way that I didn't recognize. There was like unfamiliar praise, like, that, you know, I didn't grow up with, and like just this like kind of sweetness, you know. And I don't know if it was because of the dementia or if it was because her story was now known. Like, I still will never know. But there was just, she was changing. It was like she was kind of evolving beyond the depiction of herself in the book, you know? And I realized that there was a certain pattern that we had that was shifting, but that I was still caught in the old pattern, you know? It was like my heart was still checkered with mistrust, and I was still looking at her and feeling self-protective and a little wary. And so I think I mentioned this to you, I went to see a psychic. And
but wait, why?
Because actually my editor had recommended a psychic. And I do.
Publishing these days.
That's what they do. And I do everything she says. So I went to see a psychic.
Because I'd like to actually talk to people who are not here. And your book,
I don't know what it was. I thought therapy would be too long. So I thought I could go to see a psychic. She'd pull some cards. She'd consult the stars.
One and done.
Exactly. And so I went to this person, and she was really actually very helpful. And she did pull cards, and she did consult the stars. And she said that you're locked in a soul contract with your mother, and you're going to be in a pilgrimage. And when she said that, I didn't picture like a peaceful pilgrimage, like people walking in the Santiago de Compostela, like kind of greeting fellow pilgrims. Like, I pictured something like kind of really intense. And like, so she suggested I see a psychic surgeon. So so she said that what I needed was psychic surgery. And what, anyway, she gave me the name of a person, and I was very hesitant, I have to say, because surgery sounded scary. And I thought that what's going to happen is she's going to find some like spiritual malignancy, or like do like some kind of weird, right, like cartoon exorcism, and it's going to be embarrassing, or like, so I was really wary, and I sat on this. And then I realized that I was still like, the wariness and guardedness I felt toward my mother was kind of starting to leak into other aspects of my life and other relationships, and I was like becoming kind of agoraphobic. Like, I think that it's not unusual for people who have these discoveries, NP discoveries, to walk around with a sense of guardedness, because you basically had every biographical fact you thought you knew, right, kind of sacked in a moment, right? And so I was kind of walking around sniffing for lies and like, you know, testing surfaces, like going, you know, is this wood? Yeah, it's wood. And this was overlapping with the pandemic. So it was like, not only do I have to touch it to see it's wood, I have to disinfect afterwards. Like, I was just like, I was in a state of kind of alarm, and, you know, leaving the house or like anything unpredictable, I was kind of feeling averse to doing anything out of that I couldn't predict in advance. And so I thought, you know, this isn't a healthy way to be. And so I decided to go see the surgeon.
And?
So she did this ritual, and it was, I won't get into the all the details of it, but it was like this visualization thing, and it involved these, like, basically my heart was encased in vines, and I thought the vines were alive, and she asked me to kind of take the vines off, right? And the vines had been there to protect my heart, and she said, the vines, you have to thank the vines, but they're no longer serving you, and it's time to get rid of the vines.
It's the Marie Kondo of...
Oh, it's totally the
psychic.
Thank the vines, yeah. So it was a Marie Kondo of psychic surgeons.
Yeah.
And I started to remove the vines, and then as I was removing them, I realized they weren't even alive anymore. They were brittle, they were breaking apart. Mm. And so she had me choose a box. So I, you know, in my mind, I had to choose a box. And I put the vines in the box, and then we buried the box. And anyway, there was another thing that we did. But the point is it was like somewhere between like kind of reverent ceremony and like
right.
a bit like Hasbro operation game, like where I was right. like, kind of, but it was really beautiful. And I have to say that what I realized was that, you know, storytelling can take us so far. And I'd done a lot of typing, and I put a lot of faith in the idea that storytelling would give me a sense of settledness, and it had taken me to a certain point, but, you know, writing isn't a miracle. And so, I mean, I just mentioned this because I know, you know, some people in the room write nonfiction or doing memoir-based work. I think that when we get to the end of our projects, there's often a sense of residue, like there's stuff that's left over. You know, and there's often a sense that, you know, even if we have this idea that we can write the past or there'll be some alchemical transformation through writing, that doesn't happen all the time. So I really recommend a psychic surgeon or like
and if you buy a book, she'll scrawl the number in the inside.
For sure.
Thank you so much for answering these questions. You've been incredibly generous, and I've learned a tremendous amount.